Today, I will reveal what you've all been asking for since my first video. 3, 2, 1. A picture of me, I mean David Guetta, in his early days. Wait, no. Damn, that's the wrong thing. Here's the right one, the parts list, aka bill of materials, for Flaura, my smart, self-watering plant pot. In today's video, I will go through this list and provide some additional information which will help you to order these components. I also have a special announcement to make at the end of this video, so stay tuned until then. Let's go! Flaura is my do-it-yourself open source project. If you don't know about it yet, I suggest you watch the introductory video first by following the link in the corner and then coming back to this video. It took me quite some time to make the final decisions about the hardware selection and finish the parts list, but I didn't want somebody to order the parts early and then be disappointed when something changes again. Now the waiting time is over, and the parts list is available for download. Simply follow the link in the video description to Thingiverse and find it under the Thing Files tab together with the 3D printing files. Okay, now let's take a closer look at this list. It contains the item quantity, name, description, and an example link. Plus there is a second page with some additional information. I've tried to be as specific as possible with each item to make sure you are ordering the right thing. The link at the end is just an example of what the part looks like and what the search terms might be. You may find even better deals out there. Now to the individual parts. I've divided them into three sections for better overview. The first item is a water hose made from a soft material such as PVC. The softness and inner diameter of 2 mm is necessary to fit perfectly on the connections of the pump without slipping down. The outer diameter of 4 mm creates a firm and watertight fit in the 3D printed bottom part of Flaura. The same applies to the slightly larger PVC hose with an outer diameter of 7 mm. Some cables for the water tank level sensor will run through here later. For the upper irrigation ring, we need a hose made of a harder material. Later, we will pierce several holes into this through which the water can shoot out. Initially, I tried to use a PVC hose for this as well, but it was so soft that the pierced holes closed themselves immediately. However, a harder material like PTFE, PA or PU should work perfectly. I tested the water pressure with an inner diameter of 2 mm, and also the size of the channel of the 3D printed part was designed for an outer diameter of 4 mm, so you better stick to this size. To form the irrigation ring, we need this T-shaped connector with an outer diameter of 3.2 mm. Since the hard hose is difficult to be pushed onto this, we will use two short pieces of the soft hose as a coupling. When choosing the water pump, the maximum water lift, water pressure and power consumption were among the factors that counted. But unfortunately, you rarely find a datasheet online for cheap pumps. So I ended up ordering 6 different pumps and running some tests on them. During this, the cheapest pumps that can be found en masse on eBay have turned out to be a real safety risk. After only a few hours of operation, I saw water shooting out of the cable connection onto my other electronic components. Then I broke the housing apart to take a look inside and noticed there was water and rust everywhere, even right inside the motor. It turned out that aside from some grease, these cheap water pumps have no water insulation at all. So if you don't want your electronics to blow up, do not buy these water pumps. If you would like to use a different pump than the one on the list, make sure it has 2 rubber diaphragms inside. These can be recognized by two black or transparent stripes on the outside. This ensures that the pump is not only suitable for air, but also for liquids. Last item in this section is some silicon sealant. This will be used in between the 3D printed parts and their joints with other components to achieve watertightness. Theoretically, any kind of watertight sealant should work here. So you could also use some leftovers from a previous project or buy some from a local hardware store. However, the sealant for electronic components are usually more liquid and come with a small nozzle. That helps distributing it and creating some nice looking results. The following section contains all the components that will be soldered onto the circuit board. I have chosen the THT or through-hole technology for the component size because it's much easier to solder for beginners. The list starts with a bunch of bowring resistors, capacitors and diodes. Nothing really special here. Unfortunately, you can't buy them individually, although you only need very few of them. But these are common parts that you can probably use in a later project as well. The IRLZ44N MOSFET is required to control the water pump, as it cannot be connected directly to the microcontroller. Its pins just don't provide enough current to turn a motor. Instead, we use a MOSFET which acts like a switch in this scenario. It is actuated by one of the microcontroller's digital pins and activates or deactivates the direct current flow between the battery and the pump. Be careful not to confuse the IRLZ44N with the IRFZ44N when ordering. They only differ by one letter, but are completely different parts. The L in IRLZ44N stands for logic level, which means that it was designed to be used with things like our microcontroller and only needs a small voltage at its gate pin to switch the load, which is called gate threshold voltage. If we look at the datasheet of the IRLZ44N, we can see that it has a gate threshold voltage of 1 up to 2 volts. The ESP32 runs on 3.3 volts, so that would always be enough to turn on this MOSFET. However, the IRFZ44N has a gate threshold voltage of 2 up to 4 volts, so you will always be able to turn on this MOSFET with a 5-volt Arduino, but not necessarily with a 3.3 volt ESP32. If you order the wrong MOSFET, the water pump won't work. Next on the list are one push button and one power switch. The ones I used here will perfectly fit on the circuit board and through the small holes of the 3D printed housing. The switch levers are long enough to be operated easily with your fingers. To plug in all the other components to the board, we also need a few different connectors. In order not to have a wild mix of different connector types in the end, I orientated myself to the existing connectors of the purchased parts and used these connector types for everything else as well. To connect the microcontroller to the board, we need female pin headers with 12 and 16 pins with 2.54 mm spacing. The upper four pins of the ESP32 development board won't get connected to save space and because we won't use them anyway. The soil moisture sensor is supplied with a cable and requires a male pin header with 3 pins to be connected to the circuit board. These male pin headers are separatable, so it doesn't matter which size you buy. For all other connectors, I have chosen the GSTPH type with a 2 mm pin spacing, like the battery connector on the ESP32 development board. They usually sell these connectors with the cables already on them, because putting them on is quite hard to do on your own and it requires special pliers. In our case, we need two female connectors with 2 pins, a cable length of at least 10 cm and a cable dimension of AWG 22 or 24. The AWG size refers to the conductor diameter inside the cable. A smaller number means there's more copper inside and therefore the cable can conduct more current without overheating and burning out. AWG 26 is by far the most common size for hobby electronics. And if you find an offer online that doesn't mention the cable dimension in the product description, it will almost guaranteed be this one. That being said, AWG26 is not enough for our high current wires between the battery and the pump. It will work for the water tank level sensor though. For this we need a female connector with 6 pins and a cable length of at least 30 cm. Of course, the male counterparts for these connectors are also required. The circuit board where all these components will be soldered onto was specially designed by me. It has to be custom made by one of the custom PCB manufacturers you can find online. Therefore, you will need the Gerber file, which you can find on the linked Thingiverse page as well. For those of you who are interested, I have also uploaded the circuit diagram there. The 3D printed parts are held together by a total of 22 screws with an outer diameter of 3 mm and a thread length of 8 mm. I recommend self-tapping screws like in the example link, as these hold much more firmly in the 3D printed holes than normal ones. Our ESP32 development board features a battery interface for charging 3.7 volt lithium ion batteries, which is what we will be using to power the smart plant pot. The 18650 size is a common one and describes a cylindrical battery with a diameter of 18 mm and a height of 65 mm. Make sure you buy one with the cables already attached and the right GSTPH connector. Soldering these cables to the battery yourself is quite difficult and you can easily damage the battery in the process. Another important thing is that it should have an integrated protection circuitry against overcharging and deep discharging. Check the product description for that. In terms of capacity, I recommend at least 2000 mAh to achieve a runtime of several months. But of course, more is always better. Alright, that was the easy part. For the last few items, things will get a little more complicated. The ESP32 is an excellent choice for the microcontroller, as it comes with built-in Wi-Fi and Bluetooth support, a very good power-saving mode called Deep Sleep, and because it can easily be programmed using the Arduino IDE. There are a few development boards out there that use an ESP32 chip, but also have bonus features, like voltage regulation, battery charging, and a USB interface on board, which we are looking for. To make a long battery life of several months possible, Flaura spends 99% of the day in deep sleep mode. Thus, the power consumption in deep sleep mode is one of the most important selection criteria for the ESP32 development board. Fortunately, other YouTubers like Andreas Spies and David from G6EYD have already compared different boards and taken measurements of the power consumption. Both independently came to the conclusion that the Wemos Lowland 32 is one of the boards consuming the fewest power in that mode, even less than the light version of the same Chinese brand. The manufacturer has meanwhile launched a new version of this board called Lowland D32, but unfortunately it has turned out to be a real problem to buy this new version, which is probably due to the current computer chip crisis. It feels like it's sold out like 90% of the time. For this reason, I have chosen to use the older version, Wemos Lowland 32 for Flaura. The custom circuit board and all connections are designed for exactly this development board. The downside is that this one is no longer offered by the original manufacturer, but there are many copies of it that can be found online. But be careful when ordering one of these. They all look the same at first glance, but some have cheaper electronic components soldered on them and may do not work properly. This relates in particular to the built-in LDOs, which are responsible for voltage regulation. During Wi-Fi operation of the ESP32, current peaks of up to 400 mA can occur. In order to be able to provide this voltage, Lowland and many other manufacturers use the ME6211 as the LDO. In the datasheet of the ME6211, even 500 mA are noted as the maximum output current, which would be sufficient in this case. Some of the copied boards only use an XC624 or XC625 for this, which has a maximum output current of only 150 or 300 mA. This could lead to a brownout during Wi-Fi operation, causing the processor to crash, as some users reported for similar boards on Reddit. So how can you identify the ones with proper LDOs? Simply take a look at the product pictures and zoom in as much as possible. The labeling of the market LDO is what interests us here. If you can see the MicroStar logo there, followed by one of the following letter combinations, it is the ME6211 which we are looking for. If the labeling starts with a 4A or 4B, followed by two other characters, it is one of the unwanted LDOs. Also, make sure that the development board has the right GSTPH battery connector. I didn't include an example link for this part, as I had some bad experiences when ordering and I don't want to be responsible if this happens to others. Please carefully check the product pictures before purchasing. If the image quality is too poor and you can't read the labeling on the board's components, do not order from this shop. With the capacitive soil moisture sensor, I had even greater problems finding a good supplier, as there are even greater differences between apparently identical products when it comes to the soldered on components. But I didn't want this video to become too long, and I thought that this might also be interesting for people with other plant care projects. That's why I decided to make a separate video on that, which will follow in just a few weeks. So subscribe to this channel and hit the alarm bell to not miss the release. Last but not least, there's a plastic planter on the parts list that fits into Flaura. For this it should have a height of 90 mm, an upper diameter of 110 mm and a lower diameter of 85 mm. You can easily get one of these at your local gardening store. Apart from that, such a planter is optional and you can also put the soil directly into the Flaura plant pot. Whew, we are finally done with the parts list. It took me quite a few weeks to compare the possible hardware options for each of these components in terms of specifications, quality, price, and availability. So please consider liking this video to appreciate my work. As you may have noticed, there are a lot of parts to order and many things to consider. Often parts can only be ordered in much larger quantities than required, and since they all come from different shops, the shipping costs are sometimes higher than the cost of the actual product. The example links are often shops located in China, because the prices are much lower there and other stores in Europe or America would just sell you the same products for much more money. Unfortunately, this also involves shipping times of several months. And finally, ordering the ESP32 microcontroller and the capacitive soil moisture sensor are quite a pain, as there are so many faulty imitations out there. Some of you asked if I could offer the parts for Flaura as a kit. That would of course save you guys some money, work and trouble, but it would only make sense for me if enough people were interested. To find out, I created a short Google form that you can fill out if you would like to buy such a kit. You can find the link in the video description. Alright guys, that's it for today. If you are watching this video at some day in the future, you can find the next video of this tutorial series over there. And down here is the video about the 3D printed parts for Flaura. Thanks for watching and see you next time!